work in magnesium. Warning. Keep magnesium particles away from sources of ignition. Small particles of magnesium burn very easily. In sufficient concentration, these small particles can cause an explosion. If water touches molten magnesium, a steam explosion could occur. Extinguish magnesium fires with dry talc, calcium carbonate, sand, or graphite. Apply the powder on the burning metal to a depth of 1-2 inch or more. Do not use foam, water, carbon tetrachloride, or carbon dioxide. Magnesium alloys must not touch methyl alcohol. Magnesium is the world's lightest structural metal. Like many other metals, this silvery white element is not used in its pure state for stressed application. Instead, magnesium is alloyed with certain other metals, aluminum, zinc, zirconium, manganese, thorium, and rare earth metals, to obtain the strong, lightweight alloys needed for structural uses. When alloyed with these other metals, magnesium yields alloys with excellent properties and high strength-to-weight ratios. Proper combination of these alloying constituents provide alloys suitable for sand, permanent mold and die castings, forging, extrusions, rolled sheet, and plate with good properties at room temperature, as well as at elevated temperatures. Lightweight is the best-known characteristic of magnesium, an important factor in aircraft design. In comparison, aluminum weighs 1.5 times more, iron and steel weigh 4 times more, and copper and nickel alloys weigh 5 times more. Magnesium alloys can be cut, drilled, and re-aimed with the same tools that are used on steel or brass, but the cutting edges of the tool must be sharp. Type B rivets, 5056F aluminum alloy, are used when riveting magnesium alloy parts. Magnesium parts are often repaired with CLAT 2024T3 aluminum alloy. While magnesium alloys can usually be fabricated by methods similar to those used on other metals, remember that many of the details of shop practice cannot be applied. Magnesium alloys are difficult to fabricate at room temperature, therefore, most operations must be performed at high temperatures. This requires preheating of the metal or dies, or both. Magnesium alloy sheets may be cut by blade shears, blanking dies, routers, or saws. Hand or circular saws are usually used for cutting extrusions to length. Conventional shears and nibblers should never be used for cutting magnesium alloy sheet, because they produce a rough, cracked edge. Shearing and blanking of magnesium alloys require closed tool tolerances. A maximum clearance of 3-5% of the sheet thickness is recommended. The top blade of the shears should be ground with an included angle of 45 degrees to 60 degrees. The shear angle on the punch should be from 2 degrees to 3 degrees, with a 1 degrees clearance angle on the die. For blanking, the shear angle on the die should be from 2 degrees to 3 degrees with a 1 degrees clearance angle on the punch. Hold down pressures should be used when possible. Cold shearing should not be accomplished on a hard rolled sheet thicker than 0.064 inch or a annealed sheet thicker than 1/8 inch. Shaving is used to smooth the rough, flaky edges of a magnesium sheet that has been sheared. This operation consists of removing approximately 1/32 inch by a second shearing. Hot shearing is sometimes used to obtain an improved sheared edge. This is necessary for heavy sheet and plate stock. Annealed sheet may be heated to 600 degrees F, but hard rolled sheet must be held under 400 degrees F, depending on the alloy used. Thermal expansion makes it necessary to allow for shrinkage after cooling, which entails adding a small amount of material to the cold metal dimensions before fabrication. Sawing is the only method used in cutting plate stock more than 1-2 inch thick. Bandsaw raker set blades of 4-6 tooth pitch are recommended for cutting plate stock or heavy extrusions. Small and medium extrusions are more easily cut on a circular cutoff saw having 6 teeth per inch. Sheet stock can be cut on handsaws having raker set or straight set teeth with an 8 tooth pitch. Bandsaws should be equipped with non-sparking blade guides to eliminate the danger of sparks igniting the magnesium alloy filings. Cold working most magnesium alloys at room temperature is very limited, because they work hard and rapidly, and do not lend themselves to any severe cold forming. Some simple bending operations may be performed on sheet material, but the radius of bend must be at least 7 times the thickness of the sheet for soft material, and 12 times the thickness of the sheet for hard material. A radius of 2 or 3 times the thickness of the sheet can be used, if the material is heated for the forming operation. Since wrought magnesium alloys tend to crack after they are cold worked, the best results are obtained if the metal is heated to 450 degrees F before any forming operations are attempted. Parts formed at the lower temperature range are stronger because the higher temperature range has an annealing effect on the metal. The disadvantages of hot working magnesium are: 1. Heating the dies and the material is expensive and troublesome. 2. There are problems in lubricating and handling materials at these temperatures. 4-84. The advantages to hot working magnesium are: 1. It is more easily formed when hot than are other metals. 2. Spring back is reduced, resulting in greater dimensional accuracy. When heating magnesium and its alloys, watch the temperature carefully as the metal is easily burned. Overheating also causes small molten pools to form within the metal. In either case, the metal is ruined. To prevent burning, magnesium must be protected with a sulfur dioxide atmosphere while being heated. Proper bending around a short radius requires the removal of sharp corners and burrs near the bend line. Layouts should be made with a carpenter's soft pencil, because any marring of the surface may result in fatigue cracks. Rest rakes can be used for making bends with short radii. Die and rubber methods should be used where bends are to be made at right angles, which complicate the use of a brake. Roll forming may be accomplished cold on equipment designed for forming aluminum. The most common method of forming and shallow drawing of magnesium is to use a rubber pad as the female die. This rubber pad is held in an inverted steel pan that is lowered by a hydraulic press ram. The press exerts pressure on the metal and bends it to the shape of the male die. The machining characteristics of magnesium alloys are excellent, making possible the use of maximum speeds of the machine tools with heavy cuts and high feed rates. Power requirements for machining magnesium alloys are about 1/6 of those for mild steel. Filings, shavings, and chips from machining operations should be kept in covered metal containers because of the danger of combustion. Do not use magnesium alloys in liquid de-icing and water injection systems or in the integral fuel tank areas. Working titanium. Keep titanium particles away from sources of ignition. Small particles of titanium burn very easily. In sufficient concentration, these small particles can cause an explosion. If water touches molten titanium, a steam explosion could occur. Extinguish titanium fires with dry talc, calcium carbonate, sand, or graphite. Apply the powder on the burning metal to a depth of 1-2 inch or more. Do not use foam, water, carbon tetrachloride, or carbon dioxide. Description of titanium. Titanium in its mineral state is the fourth most abundant structural metal in the Earth's crust. It is lightweight, non-magnetic, strong, corrosion-resistant, and ductile. Titanium lies between the aluminum alloys and stainless steel in modulus, density, and strength at intermediate temperatures. Titanium is 30% stronger than steel, but is nearly 50% lighter. It is 60% heavier than aluminum, but twice as strong. Titanium and its alloys are used chiefly for parts that require good corrosion resistance, moderate strength up to 600 degrees F, 315 degrees C, and lightweight. Commercially pure titanium sheet may be formed by hydro press, stretch press, brake roll forming, drop hammer, or other similar operations. It is more difficult to form than annealed stainless steel. Titanium can also be worked by grinding, drilling, sawing, and the types of working used on other metals. Titanium must be isolated from magnesium, aluminum, or alloy steel because galvanic corrosion or oxidation of the other metals occurs upon contact. Model register rivets or standard closed tolerance steel fasteners should be used when installing titanium parts. The alloy sheet can be formed, to a limited extent, at room temperature. The forming of titanium alloys is divided into three classes. Cold forming with no stress relief. Cold forming with stress relief. Elevated temperature forming, built-in stress relief. Over 5% of all titanium in the United States is produced in the form of the alloy T6-AL4V, which is known as the workhorse of the titanium industry. Used in aircraft turbine engine components and aircraft structural components, T6-AL4V is approximately 3 times stronger than pure titanium. The most widely used titanium alloy, it is hard to form. The following are procedures for cold forming titanium 6-AL4V annealed with stress relief, room temperature forming. 1. It is important to use a minimum radius chart when forming titanium, because an excessively small radius introduces excess stress to the bend area. 2. Stress relieves the part as follows. Heat the part to a temperature above 1250 degrees F, 677 degrees C, but below 1450 degrees F, 788 degrees C. Keep the part at this temperature for more than 30 minutes, but less than 10 hours. 3. A powerful press brake is required to form titanium parts. Regular hand-operated box and pan brakes cannot form titanium sheet material. 4-85. 4. A power slip roller is often used if the repair patch needs to be curved to fit the contour of the aircraft. Titanium can be difficult to drill, but standard high-speed drill bits may be used if the bits are sharp, if sufficient force is applied, and if a low-speed drill motor is used. If the drill bit is dull, or if it is allowed to ride in a partially drilled hole, an overheated condition is created, making further drilling extremely difficult. Therefore, keep holes as shallow as possible, use short, sharp drill bits of approved design, and flood the area with large amounts of cutting fluid to facilitate drilling or re-aiming. When working titanium, it is recommended that you use carbide or 8% cobalt drill bits, reamers, and countersinks. Ensure the drill or reamer is rotating to prevent scoring the side of the hole when removing either of them from a hole. Use a hand drill only when positive power feed drills are not available. The following guidelines are used for drilling titanium. The largest diameter hole that can be drilled in a single step is 0.1563 inch, because a large force is required. Larger diameter drill bits do not cut satisfactorily when much force is used. Drill bits that do not cut satisfactorily cause damage to the hole. Holes with a diameter of 0.1875 inch and larger can be hand drilled if the operator starts with a hole with a diameter of 0.1563 inch. Increases the diameter of the hole in 0.0313 inch or 0.0625 inch increments. Cobalt vanadium drill bits last much longer than HSS bits. The recommended drill motor RPM settings for hand drilling titanium are listed in Figure 4-167. The life of a drill bit is shorter when drilling titanium than when drilling steel. Do not use a blunt drill bit or let a drill bit rub the surface of the metal and not cut it. If one of these conditions occurs, the titanium surface becomes work hardened, and it is very difficult to start the drill again. When hand drilling two or more titanium parts at the same time, clamp them together tightly. The clamp. Hole size, inches, drill speed, RPM. 0.0625, 0.125, 0.1875, 920 to 1830 RPM, 460 to 920 RPM, 230 to 460 RPM. Figure 4-167. Hole size and drill speed for drilling titanium. Come together, use temporary bolts, cleco clamps, or tooling clamps. Put the clamps around the area to drill and as near the area as possible. When hand drilling thin or flexible parts, put a support, such as a block of wood, behind the part. Titanium has a low thermal conductivity. When it becomes hot, other metals become easily attached to it. Particles of titanium often become welded to the sharp edges of the drill bit if the drill speed is too high. When drilling large plates or extrusions, use a water-soluble coolant or sulfurized oil. Note: the intimate metal-to-metal contact in the metal working process creates heat and friction that must be reduced, or the tools and the sheet metal used in the process are quickly damaged and/or destroyed. Coolants, also called cutting fluids, are used to reduce the friction at the interface of the tool and sheet metal by transferring heat away from the tool and sheet metal. Thus, the use of cutting fluids increases productivity, extends tool life, and results in a higher quality of workmanship. Basic principles of sheet metal repair. Aircraft structural members are designed to perform a specific function or to serve a definite purpose. The primary objective of aircraft repair is to restore damaged parts to their original condition. Very often, replacement is the only way this can be done effectively. When repair of a damaged part is possible, first study the part carefully to fully understand its purpose or function. Strength may be the principal requirement in the repair of certain structures, while others may need entirely different qualities. For example, fuel tanks and floats must be protected against leakage, cowlings, fairings, and similar parts must have such properties as neat appearance, streamlined shape, and accessibility. The function of any damaged part must be carefully determined to ensure the repair meets the requirements. An inspection of the damage and accurate estimate of the type of repair required are the most important steps in repairing structural damage. The inspection includes an estimate of the best type and shape of repair patch to use, the type, size, and number of rivets needed, and the strength, thickness, and kind of material required to make the repaired member no heavier, or only slightly heavier, and just as strong as the original. When investigating damage to an aircraft, it is necessary to make an extensive inspection of the structure. When any component or group of components has been damaged, it is essential that both the damaged members and the attaching. 4-86. Structure be investigated. Since the damaging force may have been transmitted over a large area, sometimes quite remote from the point of original damage. Wrinkled skin, elongated or damaged boulder rivet holes, or distortion of members usually appears in the immediate area of such damage, and any one of these conditions calls for a close inspection of the adjacent area. Check all skin, dents, and wrinkles for any cracks or abrasions. Non-destructive inspection methods, NDI, are used as required when inspecting damage. NDI methods serve as tools of prevention that allow defects to be detected before they develop into serious or hazardous failures. A trained and experienced technician can detect flaws or defects with a high degree of accuracy and reliability. Some of the defects found by NDI include corrosion, pitting, heat/stress cracks, and discontinuity of metals. When investigating damage, proceed as follows. Remove all dirt, grease, and paint from the damaged and surrounding areas to determine the exact condition of each rivet, bolt, and weld. Inspect skin for wrinkles throughout a large area. Check the operation of all movable parts in the area. Determine if repair would be the best procedure. In any aircraft sheet metal repair, it is critical to maintain original strength, maintain original contour, and minimize weight. Maintaining original strength. Certain fundamental rules must be observed if the original strength of the structure is to be maintained. Ensure that the cross-sectional area of a splice or patch is at least equal to or greater than that of the damaged part. Avoid abrupt changes in cross-sectional area. Eliminate dangerous stress concentration by tapering splices. To reduce the possibility of cracks starting from the corners of cutouts, try to make cutouts either circular or oval in shape. Where it is necessary to use a rectangular cutout, make the radius of curvature at each corner no smaller than 1-2 inch. If the member is subjected to compression or bending loads, the patch should be placed on the outside of the member to obtain a higher resistance to such loads. If the patch cannot be placed there, material 1 gauge thicker than the original shall be used for the repair. Replace buckled or bent members, or reinforce them by attaching a splice over the affected area. A buckled part of the structure shall not be depended upon to carry its load again, no matter how well the part may be strengthened. The material used in all replacements or reinforcements must be similar to that used in the original structure. If an alloy weaker than the original must be substituted for it, a heavier thickness must be used to give equivalent cross-sectional strength. a material that is stronger, but thinner, and not be substituted for the original, because one material can have greater tensile strength, but less compressive strength than another, or vice versa. Also, the buckling and torsional strength of many sheet metal and tubular parts depends primarily on the thickness of the material, rather than its allowable compressive and shear strengths. The manufacturer's SRM often indicates what material can be used as a substitution, and how much thicker the material needs to be. Figure 4-168 is an example of a substitution table found in an SRM. Air must be taken when forming. Heat-treated and cold-worked aluminum alloys stand very little bending without cracking. On the other hand, soft alloys are easily formed, but they are not strong enough for primary structure. Strong alloys can be formed and are annealed, heated and allowed to cool slowly, conditioned, and heat-treated, before assembling to develop their strength. The size of rivets for any repair can be determined by referring to the rivets used by the manufacturer and the next parallel rivet row inboard on the wing or forward on the fuselage. Another method of determining the size of rivets to be used is to multiply the thickness of the skin by 3 and use the next larger size rivet corresponding to that figure. For example, if the skin thickness is 0.040 inch, multiply 0.040 inch by 3, which equals 0.120 inch, use the next larger size rivet, 1/8 inch, 0.125 inch. The number of rivets to be used for a repair can be found in tables in manufacturer's SRMs or in advisory circular AC 43.13-1, as revised, acceptable methods, techniques, and practices aircraft inspection and repair. Figure 4-169 is a table from AC 43.13-1 that is used to calculate the number of rivets required for a repair. Extensive repairs that are made too strong can't be as undesirable as repairs weaker than the original structure. All aircraft structure must flex slightly to withstand the forces imposed during takeoff, flight, and landing. If a repaired area is too strong, excessive flexing occurs at the edge of the completed repair, causing acceleration of metal fatigue. 4-87. Shape initial material. Lat 2024 T42. F. Sheet 0.016 to 0.125. A. Lat 2024 T3. A. Formed or extruded section. Lat 7075 T6. 2024 T42. F. Replacement material. Lat 2024 T3 2024 T3 Lat 7075 T6 7075 T6. 2024 T3 Lat 7075 T6 7075 T6. 7075 T6. 7075 T6. A. B. Sheet material to be replaced. Material replacement factor. Lat 7075 T6. 7075 T6 2024 T3. Lat 2024 T3. FF. 2024 T4. 2024 T42. G. H. C. 1.00. 1.00. 1.00. 1.00. 1.00. 1.00. 1.28. 1.08. 1.00. A. 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 CH. 1.10. 1.00. 1.00. 1.00. 1.00. 1.00. 1.28, 1.18, 1.00, D, E, D, E, D, E, Lat 2024 T4, Lat 2024 T42, D, E, A, 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 1.20, 1.13, 1.00, 1.00, 1.00, 1.00, 1.50, 1.41, 1.00, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, 7075 T6, Lat 7075 T6, 2024 T3, Lat 2024 T3, 2024 T42, Lat 2024 T42, 7178 T6, Lat 7178 T6, 5052 H34. Notes: all dimensions are in inches, unless given differently. It is possible that more protection from corrosion will be necessary when bare mineral is used to replace clad material. Refer to 51-10-2. It is possible for the material replacement factor to be a lower value for a specific location on the airplane. To get that value, contact Boeing for a case-by-case analysis. Refer to Figure 3 for mini mud bend radii. Example: to refer 0.040 thick 7075 T6 with clad 7075 T6, multiply the gauge by the material replacement factor to get the replacement gauge 0.040 × 1.10 equals 0.045, 1.78, 1.70, 1.00, 1.00, 1.00, 1.00, 1.90, 1.75, 1.00, 1.30, 1.22, 1.09, 1.00, 1.00, 1.00, 1.63, 1.52, 1.00, 1.83, 1.76, 1.10, 1.00, 1.00, 1.00, 2.00, 1.83, 1.00, 1.20, 1.13, 1.00, 1.00, 1.00, 1.00, 1.86, 1.75, 1.00, 1.78, 1.71, 1.10, 1.00, 1.00, 1.00, 1.90, 1.75, 1.00, 1.24, 1.16, 1.03, 1.03, 1.00, 1.00, 1.96, 1.81, 1.00, 1.84, 1.76, 1.14, 1.00, 1.14, 1.00, 1.98, 1.81, 1.00.
These materials cannot be used as replacements for the initial material in areas that are pressured. They also cannot be used in the wing interspar structure at the wing center section structure. Use the next thicker standard gauge when you use a form section as a replacement for an extrusion. For all gauges of flat sheet and form sections. For flat sheet less than 0.071 thick. For flat sheet 0.071 thick and thicker, and for form sections. 2024 T4 and 2024 T42 are equivalent. A compound to give protection from corrosion must be applied to bare material that is used to replace 5052H34. Figure 4-168. Material substitution. Shear strength and bearing strength. Aircraft structural joint design involves an attempt to find the optimum strength relationship between being critical in shear and critical in bearing. These are determined by the failure mode affecting the joint. The joint is critical in shear if less than the optimum number of fasteners of a given size are installed. This means that the rivets will fail, and not the sheet, if the joint fails. The joint is critical in bearing, if more than the optimum number of fasteners of a given size are installed, the material may crack and tear between holes, or fastener holes may distort and stretch while the fasteners remain intact. 4-88. Thickness T in inches. No. Of 2117 T4, AD, protruding head rivets require per inch of width W. No. Of bolts. Rivet size 3/32 and 185/32 and 3/16 1/4 and 3. 6.5, 6.5, 6.9, 8.9, 10.0, 11.1, 4.9, 4.9, 4.9, 4.9, 5.6, 6.2, 7.9, 9.9, 12.5, minus 3.9, 3.9, 3.9, 3.9, 4.0, 5.1, 6.5, 8.1, 9.1, 10.3, 12.9, minus 3.3, 3.3, 3.3, 3.6, 4.5, 5.7, 6.3, 7.1, 8.9, minus 2.4, 2.4, 2.4, 2.5, 3.1, 3.5, 3.9, 4.9, minus 3.3, 3.3, 3.3, 3.3, 3.3, 3.3, 0.016, 0.020, 0.025, 0.032, 0.036, 0.040, 0.051, 0.064, 0.081, 0.091, 0.102, 0.128. Note A. For stringer in the upper surface of a wing, or in a fuselage, 80% of the number of rivets shown in the table may be used. B. For intermediate frames, 60% of the number shown may be used. C. For single lap sheet joints, 75% of the number shown may be used. Engineering Notes A. The load per inch of width of material was calculated by assuming a strip 1 inch wide and tension. B. Number of rivets required was calculated for 2117 T4, AD, rivets, based on the rivet allowable shear stress equal to percent of the sheet allowable tensile stress, and the sheet allowable bearing stress equal to 160% of the sheet allowable tensile stress, using nominal hole diameters for rivets. C. Combinations of shoot thickness and rivet size above the underlying numbers are critical in, i.e., will fail by, bearing on the sheet, those below are critical in shearing of the rivets. D. The number of and three bolts required below the underlying number was calculated based on the sheet allowable tensile stress of 55.000 psi and a bolt allowable single shear load of 2.126 pounds. Figure 4-169. Rivet calculation table. Maintaining original contour. Form all repairs in such a manner to fit the original contour perfectly. A smooth contour is especially desirable when making patches on the smooth external skin of high-speed aircraft. Keeping weight to a minimum. Keep the weight of all repairs to a minimum. Make the size of the patches as small as practicable and use no more rivets than are necessary. In many cases, repairs disturb the original balance of the structure. The addition of excessive weight in each repair may unbalance the aircraft, requiring adjustment of the trim and balance tabs. In areas such as the spinner on the propeller, a repair requires application of balancing patches in order to maintain a perfect balance of the propeller. When flight controls are repaired and weight is added, it is very important to perform a balancing check to determine if the flight control is still within its balance limitations. Failure to do so could result in flight control flutter. Flutter and vibration precautions. To prevent severe vibration or flutter of flight control surfaces during flight, precautions must be taken to stay within the design balance limitations when performing maintenance or repair. The importance of retaining the proper balance and rigidity of aircraft control surfaces cannot be overemphasized. The effect of repair weight change on the balance and CG is proportionately greater on lighter surfaces than on the older, heavier designs. As a general rule, repair the control surface in such a manner that the weight distribution is not affected in any way, in order to preclude the occurrence of flutter of the control surface in flight. Under certain conditions, counterbalance weight is added forward of the hinge line to maintain balance. Add or remove balance weights only when necessary in accordance with the manufacturer's instructions. Flight testing must be accomplished to ensure flutter is not a problem. Failure to check and retain control surface balance within the original or maximum allowable value could result in a serious flight hazard. 4-89. Aircraft manufacturers use different repair techniques, and repairs designed and approved for one type of aircraft are not automatically approved for other types of aircraft. When repairing a damaged component or part, consult the applicable section of the manufacturer's SRM for the aircraft. Usually the SRM contains an illustration for a similar repair along with a list of the types of material, rivets and rivet spacing, and the methods and procedures to be used. Any additional knowledge needed to make a repair is also detailed. If the necessary information is not found in the SRM, attempt to find a similar repair or assembly installed by the manufacturer of the aircraft. Inspection of damage. When visually inspecting damage, remember that there may be other kinds of damage than that caused by impact from foreign objects or collision. A rough landing may overload one of the landing gear, causing it to become sprung. This would be classified as load damage. During inspection and sizing up of the repair job, consider how far the damage caused by the sprung shock strut extends to supporting structural members. A shock occurring at one end of a member is transmitted throughout its length. Therefore, closely inspect all rivets, bolts, and attaching structures along the complete member for any evidence of damage. Make a close examination for rivets that have partially failed and for holes that have been elongated. Whether specific damage is suspected or not, an aircraft structure must occasionally be inspected for structural integrity. The following paragraphs provide general guidelines for this inspection. When inspecting the structure of an aircraft, it is very important to watch for evidence of corrosion on the inside. This is most likely to occur in pockets and corners where moisture and salt spray may accumulate. Therefore, drain holes must always be kept clean. While an injury to the skin covering caused by impact with an object is plainly evident, a defect, such as distortion or failure of the substructure, may not be apparent until some evidence develops on the surface, such as canted, buckled or wrinkled covering and loose rivets or working rivets. A working rivet is one that has movement under structural stress, but is not loosened to the extent that movement can be observed. This situation can sometimes be noted by a dark, greasy residue of deterioration of paint and primers around rivet heads. External indications of internal injury must be watched for and correctly interpreted. When found, an investigation of the substructure in the vicinity should be made and corrective action taken. Warped wings are usually indicated by the presence of parallel skin wrinkles running diagonally across the wings and extending over a major area. This condition may develop from unusually violent maneuvers, extremely rough air, or extra hard landings. While there may be no actual rupture of any part of the structure, it may be distorted and weakened. Similar failures may also occur in fuselages. Small cracks in the skin covering may be caused by vibration, and they are frequently found leading away from rivets. Aluminum alloy surfaces having chipped protective coating, scratches, or worn spots that expose the surface of the metal should be recoated at once, as corrosion may develop rapidly. The same principle is applied to aluminum clad, Alclad trademark, surfaces. Scratches, which penetrate the pure aluminum surface layer, permit corrosion to take place in the alloy beneath. A simple visual inspection cannot accurately determine if suspected cracks in major structural members actually exist, or the full extent of the visible cracks. Eddy current and ultrasonic inspection techniques are used to find hidden damage. Types of damage and defects. Types of damage and defects that may be observed on aircraft parts are defined as follows. Crinkling occurrence of shallow, spherical depressions in a surface, usually produced by a part having a small radius in contact with the surface under high load. Burnishing, polishing of one surface by sliding contact with a smooth, harder surface. Usually there is no displacement or removal of metal. Burr, a small, thin section of metal extending beyond the regular surface, usually located at a corner or on the edge of a hole. Corrosion, loss of metal from the surface by chemical or electrochemical action. The corrosion products generally are easily removed by mechanical means. Iron rust is an example of corrosion. Crack a physical separation of two adjacent portions of metal, evidenced by a fine or thin line across the surface caused by excessive stress at that point. It may extend inward from the surface from a few thousandths of an inch to completely through the section thickness. Cut loss of metal, usually to an appreciable depth over a relatively long and narrow area, by mechanical. 4-90. Means, as would occur with the use of a saw blade, chisel, or sharp-edged stone striking a glancing blow. Dent indentation in a metal surface produced by an object striking with force. The surface surrounding the indentation is usually slightly upset. Erosion loss of metal from the surface by mechanical action of foreign objects, such as grit or fine sand. The eroded area is rough, and may be lined in the direction in which the foreign material moved relative to the surface. Shattering breakdown or deterioration of metal surface by vibratory or chattering action. Although shattering may give the general appearance of metal loss or surface cracking, usually, neither has occurred. Galling breakdown, or buildup, of metal surfaces due to excessive friction between two parts having relative motion. Particles of the softer metal are torn loose and welded to the harder metal. Gouge proven, or breakdown of, a metal surface from contact with foreign material under heavy pressure. Usually it indicates metal loss, but may be largely the displacement of material. Inclusion presence of foreign or extraneous material wholly within a portion of metal. Such material is introduced during the manufacture of rod, bar or tubing by rolling or forging. Hit local break or notch on an edge. Usually it involves the displacement of metal rather than loss. Hitting sharp, localized breakdown, small, deep cavity, of metal surface, usually with defined edges. Scratch slight tear or break in metal surface from light, momentary contact by foreign material. Score deeper than scratch, tear or break in metal surface from contact under pressure. May show discoloration from temperature produced by friction. Stain a change in color, locally causing a noticeably different appearance from the surrounding area. Upsetting a displacement of material beyond the normal contour or surface, a local bulge or bump. Usually it indicates no metal loss. Classification of damage. Damages may be grouped into four general classes. In many cases, the availabilities of repair materials and time are the most important factors in determining if a part should be repaired or replaced. Negligible damage. Negligible damage consists of visually apparent surface damage that do not affect the structural integrity of the component involved. Negligible damage may be left as is or may be corrected by a simple procedure without restricting flight. In both cases, some corrective action must be taken to keep the damage from spreading. Negligible or minor damage areas must be inspected frequently to ensure the damage does not spread. Permissible limits for negligible damage vary for different components of different aircraft and should be carefully researched on an individual basis. Failure to ensure that damages within the specified limit of negligible damage may result in insufficient structural strength of the affected support member for critical flight conditions. Small dents, scratches, cracks, and holes that can be repaired by smoothing, sanding, stop drilling, or hammering out, or otherwise repaired without the use of additional materials, fall in this classification. Figure 4-170. Damage repairable by patching. Damage repairable by patching is any damage exceeding negligible damage limits that can be repaired by installing splice members to bridge the damaged portion of a structural part. The splice members are designed to span the damaged areas and to overlap the existing undamaged surrounding structure. The splicer patch material used in internal riveted and bolted repairs is normally the same type of material as the damaged part, but one gauge heavier. In a patch repair, filler plates of the same gauge and type of material as that in the damaged component may be used for bearing purposes or to return the damaged part to its original contour. Structural fasteners are applied to members and the surrounding structure to restore the original load-carrying characteristics. Crack. Stop drill cracks. Figure 4-170. Repair of cracks by stop drilling. 4-91. Of the damaged area. The use of patching depends on the extent of the damage and the accessibility of the component to be repaired. Damage repairable by insertion. Damage must be repaired by insertion when the area is too large to be patched or the structure is arranged such that repair members would interfere with structural alignment, e.g., in a hinge or bulkhead. In this type of repair, the damaged portion is removed from the structure and replaced by a member identical in material and shape. Splice connections at each end of the insertion member provide for load transfer to the original structure. Damage necessitating replacement of parts. Components must be replaced when their location or extent of damage makes repair impractical, when replacement is more economical than repair, or when the damaged part is relatively easy to replace. For example, replacing damaged castings, forgings, hinges, and small structural members, when available, is more practical than repairing them. Some highly stressed members must be replaced, because repair would not restore an adequate margin of safety. Repairability of sheet metal structure. The following criteria can be used to help an aircraft technician decide upon the repairability of a sheet metal structure. Type of damage. Type of original material. Location of the damage. Type of repair required. Tools and equipment available to make the repair. The following methods, procedures, and materials are only typical and should not be used as the authority for a repair. Structural support during repair. During repair, the aircraft must be adequately supported to prevent further distortion or damage. It is also important that the structure adjacent to the repair is supported when it is subject to static loads. The aircraft structure can be supported adequately by the landing gear or by jacks where the work involves a repair, such as removing the control surfaces, wing panels, or stabilizers. Cradles must be prepared to hold these components while they are removed from the aircraft. When the work involves extensive repair of the fuselage, landing gear, or wing center section, a jig, a device for holding parts in position to maintain their shape, may be constructed to distribute the loads while repairs are being accomplished. Figure 4-171 shows a typical aircraft jig. 16. CL 35/8 75/8 CL 24 222444 35/8 71/4 35/8 67/8 39/16 35/16 61/4 355/8 21/8 43/4 55/8 48 3/8 21/8 23/4 515/41/4 30 1/4 felt glued on canvas or strong cloth tacked on to cover felt 1/4 plywood both sides 2x8 2x3 30 Figure 4-171 aircraft jig used to hold components during repairs. Always check the applicable aircraft maintenance manual for specific support requirements. Assessment of damage. Before starting any repair, the extent of damage must be fully evaluated to determine if repair is authorized or even practical. This evaluation should identify the original material used and the type of repair required. The assessment of the damage begins with an inspection of riveted joints and an inspection for corrosion. Inspection of riveted joints. Inspection consists of examining both the shop and manufactured heads and the surrounding skin and structural parts for deformities. During the repair of an aircraft structural part, examine adjacent parts to determine the condition of neighboring rivets. The presence of chipped or cracked paint around the heads may indicate shifted or loose rivets. If the heads are tipped, or if rivets are loose, they show up in groups of several consecutive rivets and are probably tipped in the same direction. If heads that appear to be tipped are not in groups, 4-92, and are not tipped in the same direction, tipping may have occurred during some previous installation. Inspect rivets that are known to have been critically loaded, but that show no visible distortion, by drilling off the head and carefully punching out the shank. If upon examination, the shank appears joggled and the holes in the sheet misaligned, the rivet has failed in shear. In that case, determine what is causing the stress and take necessary corrective action. Countersunk rivets that show head slippage within the countersink or dimple, indicating either sheet bearing failure or rivet shear failure, must be replaced. Joggles and removed rivet shanks indicate partial shear failure. Replace these rivets with the next larger size. Also, if the rivet holes show elongation, replace the rivets with the next larger size. Sheet failures, such as tear-outs, cracks between rivets, and the like, usually indicate damaged rivets, and the complete repair of the joint may require replacement of the rivets with the next larger size. The presence of a black residue around the rivets is not an indication of looseness, but it is an indication of movement, fretting. The residue, which is aluminum oxide, is formed by a small amount of relative motion between the rivet and the adjacent surface. This is called fretting corrosion, or smoking, because the aluminum dust quickly forms a dark, dirty-looking trail, like a smoke trail. Sometimes, the thinning of the moving pieces can propagate a crack. If a rivet is suspected of being defective, this residue may be removed with a general-purpose abrasive hand pad, such as those manufactured by Scotch Brita trademark, and the surface inspected for signs of pitting or cracking. Although the condition indicates the component is under significant stress, it does not necessarily precipitate cracking. Figure 4-172. Airframe cracking is not necessarily caused by defective rivets. It is common practice in the industry to size rivet patterns assuming one or more of the rivets is not effective. This means that a loose rivet would not necessarily overload adjacent rivets to the point of cracking. Figure 4-172. Smoking rivet. Rivet head cracking are acceptable under the following conditions. The depth of the crack is less than 1/8 of the shank diameter. The width of the crack is less than 1/16 of the shank diameter. The length of the crack is confined to an area on the head within a circle, having a maximum diameter of 1/14 times the shank diameter. Cracks should not intersect, which creates the potential for the loss of a portion of a head. Inspection for corrosion. Corrosion is the gradual deterioration of metal due to a chemical or electrochemical reaction with its environment. The reaction can be triggered by the atmosphere, moisture, or other agents. When inspecting the structure of an aircraft, it is important to watch for evidence of corrosion on both the outside and inside. Corrosion on the inside is most likely to occur in pockets and corners where moisture and salt spray may accumulate. Therefore, drain holes must always be kept clean. Also inspect the surrounding members for evidence of corrosion. Damage removal. To prepare a damaged area for repair. 1. Remove all distorted skin and structure in damaged area. 2. Remove damaged material so that the edges of the completed repair match existing structure and aircraft lines. 3. Ground all square corners. 4. Smooth out any abrasions and/or dents. 5. Remove and incorporate into the new repair any previous repairs joining the area of the new repair. Repair material selection. The repair material must duplicate the strength of the original structure. If an alloy weaker than the original material has to be used, a heavier gauge must be used to give equivalent cross-sectional strength. A lighter gauge material should not be used, even when using a stronger alloy. Repair parts layout. All new sections fabricated for repairing or replacing damaged parts in a given aircraft should be carefully laid out to the dimensions listed in the applicable aircraft manual before fitting the parts into the structure. 4-93. Rivet selection. Normally, the rivet size and material should be the same as the original rivets in the part being repaired. If a rivet hole has been enlarged or deformed, the next larger size rivet must be used after reworking the hole. When this is done, the proper edge distance for the larger rivet must be maintained. Where access to the inside of the structure is impossible and blind rivets must be used in making the repair, always consult the applicable aircraft maintenance manual for the recommended type, size, spacing, and number of rivets needed to replace either the original installed rivets or those that are required for the type of repair being performed. Rivet spacing and edge distance. The rivet pattern for a repair must conform to instructions in the applicable aircraft manual. The existing rivet pattern is used whenever possible. Corrosion treatment. Prior to assembly of repair or replacement parts, make certain that all existing corrosion has been removed in the area and that the parts are properly insulated one from the other. Approval of repair. Once the need for an aircraft repair has been established, Title 14 of the Code of Federal Regulations, 14 CFR, defines the approval process. 14 CFR Part 43, Section 43.13a, states that each person performing maintenance, alteration, or preventive maintenance on an aircraft, engine, propeller, or appliance shall use the methods, techniques, and practices prescribed in the current manufacturer's maintenance manual or instructions for continued airworthiness prepared by its manufacturer, or other methods, techniques, or practices acceptable to the administrator. AC 43.13-1 contains methods, techniques, and practices acceptable to the administrator for the inspection and repair of non-pressurized areas of civil aircraft, only when there are no manufacturer repair or maintenance instructions. This data generally pertains to minor repairs. The repairs identified in this AC may only be used as a basis for FAA approval for major repairs. The repair data may also be used as approved data, and the AC chapter, page, and paragraph listed in Block 8 of FAA Form 337 when A. The user has determined that it is appropriate to the product being repaired. B. It is directly applicable to the repair being made. And C. It is not contrary to manufacturer's data. Engineering support from the aircraft manufacturer is required for repair techniques and methods that are not described in the aircraft maintenance manual or SRM. FAA Form 337, major repair and alteration, must be completed for repairs to the following parts of an airframe and repairs of the following types involving the strengthening, reinforcing, splicing, and manufacturing of primary structural members or their replacement, when replacement is by fabrication, such as riveting or welding. Figure 4-173. Ox beams. MONOCOQUEORSEMIMONOCOQUEWINGSOR control surfaces. Wing stringers or cord members. Spars. Spar flanges. Members of truss type beams. Thin sheet webs of beams. Keel and chine members of boat hulls or floats. Corrugated sheet compression members that act as flange material of wings or tail surfaces. Wing main ribs and compression members. Wing or tail surface brace struts, fuselage lamburins. Members of the side truss, horizontal truss, or bulkheads. Main seat support braces and brackets. Landing gear brace struts. Repairs involving the substitution of material. Repair of damaged areas in metal or plywood stress covering exceeding 6 inches in any direction. Repair of portions of skin sheets by making additional seams. Splicing of thin sheets. Repair of three or more adjacent wing or control surface ribs or the leading edge of wings and control surfaces between such adjacent ribs. For major repairs made in accordance with a manual or specifications acceptable to the administrator, a certificated repair station may use the customer's work order upon which the repair is recorded in place of the FAA Form 337. Repair of stressed skin structure. In aircraft construction, stressed skin is a form of construction in which the external covering, skin, of an aircraft carries part or all of the main loads. Stressed skin is made from high-strength rolled aluminum sheets. Stressed skin carries a large portion of the load imposed upon an aircraft structure. Various specific skin areas are classified as highly critical, semi-critical, 4-94. Major repair and alteration, U.S. Department of Transportation, airframe, power plant, propeller, or appliance, Federal Aviation Administration. 1. Aircraft. 2. Owner. Name, address, city, state. Zip country. Signature / date of authorized individual. OMDO. 2120-0020. Exp. 5/31/2018. Electronic tracking number, for FAA use only. Instructions, printer type all entries. See Title 14 CFR Section 43.9, Art 43 Appendix B, and AC 43.9-1, or subsequent revision thereof, for instructions and disposition of this form. This report is required by law, 49 U.S.C., Section 44701. Failure to report can result in a civil penalty for each such violation. 49 U.S.C., Section 46301, A. Nationality and registration mark serial no. Make model series. Name, as shown on registration certificate. Address, as shown on registration certificate. Address city state zip country. 3. For FAA use only. 4. Type 5. Unit identification. Repair alteration unit make model serial no. Airframe, as described in item 1 above. Power plant. Propeller. Type. Appliance. Manufacturer. 6. Conformity statement. A. Agency's name and address. B. Kind of agency. U. S. Certificated mechanic manufacturer. Foreign certificated mechanic. C. Certificate no. Certificated repair station. Certificated maintenance organization. D. I certify that the repair and or alteration made to the units identified in item 5 above and described on the reverser attachments hereto have been made in accordance with the requirements of Part 43 of the U.S. Federal Aviation Regulations, and that the information furnished herein is true and correct to the best of my knowledge. Extended range fuel for 14 CFR Part 43. App. B. 7. Approval for return to service. Pursuant to the authority given persons specified below, the unit identified in item 5 was inspected in the manner prescribed by the Administrator of the Federal Aviation Administration, and is approved rejected. FAA FLT. Standards Inspector. Manufacturer Maintenance Organization. Persons approved by Canadian Department of Transport. By. Other. Specify. FAA Designee Repair Station Inspection Authorization. Certificate or designation no. Signature slash date of authorized individual. FAA Form 337-10-06. Figure 4-173. FAA Form 337. Major repair and alteration. Airframe, power plant, propeller, or appliance. 4-95. Notice. Weight and balance or operating limitation changes shall be entered in the appropriate aircraft record. An alteration must be compatible with all previous alterations to assure continued conformity with the applicable airworthiness requirements. 8. Description of work accomplished. If more space is required, attach additional sheets. Identify with aircraft nationality and registration mark and date work completed. Nationality and registration M mark date. Additional sheets are attached. FAA Form 337-10-06. Figure 4-173. FAA Form 337. Major repair and alteration, airframe, power plant, propeller, or appliance, continued. 4-96. Or non-critical. To determine specific repair requirements for these areas, refer to the applicable aircraft maintenance manual. Minor damage to the outside skin of the aircraft can be repaired by applying a patch to the inside of the damaged sheet. A filler plug must be installed in the hole made by the removal of the damaged skin area. It plugs the hole and forms a smooth outside surface necessary for aerodynamic smoothness of the aircraft. The size and shape of the patch is determined in general by the number of rivets required in the repair. If not otherwise specified, calculate the required number of rivets by using the rivet formula. Make the patch plate of the same material as the original skin and of the same thickness or of the next greater thickness. Patches. Skin patches may be classified as two types. Laparoscap patch, flush patch. Laparoscap patch. The laparoscap type of patch is an external patch where the edges of the patch and the skin overlap each other. The overlapping portion of the patch is riveted to the skin. Lap patches may be used in most areas where aerodynamic smoothness is not important. Figure 4-174 shows a typical patch for a crack and, or for a hole. When repairing cracks or small holes with a laparoscap patch, the damage must be cleaned and smoothed. In repairing cracks, a small hole must be drilled in each end and sharp end of the crack before applying the patch. These holes relieve the stress at these points and prevent the crack from spreading. The patch must be large enough to install the required number of rivets. It may be cut circular, square, or rectangular. If it is cut square or rectangular, the corners are rounded to a radius no smaller than 1/4 inch. The edges must be chamfered to an angle of 45 degrees for 1/2 the thickness of the material, and bent down 5 degrees over the edge distance to seal the edges. This reduces the chance that the repair is affected by the airflow over it. These dimensions are shown in Figure 4-175. Flush patch. A flush patch is a filler patch that is flush to the skin. When applied, it is supported by and riveted to a reinforcement plate, which is, in turn, riveted to the inside of the skin. Figure 4-176 shows a typical flush patch repair. The doubler is inserted through the opening and rotated until it slides in place under the skin. The filler must be of the same gauge and material as the original skin. The doubler should be of material 1 gauge heavier than the skin. Original damage. Stop holes, drill 3/32 diameter holes in each sharp corner or crack or break and clean up edges. Skin. Reinforcement material outlet 2024T3. Same gauge or 1 gauge heavier. Rivets material thickness of 0.032 inch or less. Used. 1/8 rivets material thickness greater than 0.032. Use 5/32 rivets. Space rivets approximately 1 apart and staggered rows 1/2 apart. Maintain minimum edge distance of 1 when skin thickness is 0.032 or less and 1/8 when skin thickness is more than 0.032. Minimum edge distance using 1/8 rivets is 1/4 and using 5/32 rivets is 5/16. Figure 4-174. Lapper scab patch, crack. Rivet hole edge distance. 5 degrees. 45 degrees. Neutral axis. T. 1/2 T. Figure 4-175. Lap patch edge preparation. Open and closed skin area repair. The factors that determine the methods to be used in skin repair are accessibility to the damaged area and the instructions found in the aircraft maintenance manual. The skin on most areas of an aircraft is inaccessible for making the repair from the inside and is known as closed skin. Skin that is accessible from both sides is called open skin. 4-97. Damage. E. Insertion. E. Doubler. Damaged area cut to a smooth rectangle with corner rattle. Skin. E. Doubler. Insertion. Filler. Doubler. Insertion patch method. Patch. Skin. Doubler riveted in place. Skin. 1/4 inch deep dent. Cover patch method. Figure 4-177. Repair patch for a non-pressurized area. Filler riveted in place. Figure 4-176. Typical flush patch repair. Usually, repairs to open skin can be made in the conventional manner using standard rivets, but in repairing closed skin, some type of special fastener must be used. The exact type to be used depends on the type of repair being made and the recommendations of the aircraft manufacturer. Design of a patch for a non-pressurized area. Damage to the aircraft skin in a non-pressurized area can be repaired by a flush patch if a smooth skin surface is required, or by an external patch in non-critical areas. Figure 4-177. The first step is to remove the damage. Cut the damage to a round, oval, or rectangular shape. Round all corners of a rectangular patch to a minimum radius of 0.5 inch. The minimum edge distance used is 2 times the diameter, and the rivet spacing is typically between 4-6 times the diameter. The size of the doubler depends on the edge distance and rivet spacing. The doubler material is of the same material as the damaged skin, but of 1 thickness greater than the damaged skin. The size of the doubler depends on the edge distance and rivet spacing. The insert is made of the same material and thickness as the damaged skin. The size and type of rivets should be the same as rivets used for similar joints on the aircraft. The SRM indicates what size and type of rivets to use. Typical repairs for aircraft structures. This section describes typical repairs of the major structural parts of an airplane. When repairing a damaged component or part, consult the applicable section of the manufacturers. 4-98. SRM for the aircraft. Normally, a similar repair is illustrated, and the types of material, rivets, and rivet spacing, and the methods and procedures to be used are listed. Any additional knowledge needed to make a repair is also detailed. If the necessary information is not found in the SRM, attempt to find a similar repair assembly installed by the manufacturer of the aircraft. Floats. To maintain the float in an airworthy condition, periodic and frequent inspections should be made because of the rapidity of corrosion on metal parts, particularly when the aircraft is operated in salt water. Inspection of floats and hulls involves examination for damage due to corrosion, collision with other objects, hard landings, and other conditions that may lead to failure. Note: blind rivets should not be used on floats or amphibian hulls below the waterline. Sheet metal floats should be repaired using approved practices. However, the seams between sections of sheet metal should be waterproof with suitable fabric and sealing compound. A float that has undergone hull repairs should be tested by filling it with water and allowing it to stand for at least 24 hours to see if any leaks develop. Figure 4-178. Corrugated skin repair. Some of the flight controls of smaller general aviation aircraft have beads in their skin panels. The beads give some stiffness to the thin skin panels. The beads for the repair patch can be formed with a rotary former or press brake. Figure 4-179. Replacement of a panel. Damage to metal aircraft skin that exceeds repairable limits requires replacement of the entire panel. Figure 4-180. A panel must also be replaced when there are too many previous repairs in a given section or area. In aircraft construction, a panel is any single sheet of metal covering. A panel section is the part of a panel between adjacent stringers and bulkheads, where a section of skin is damaged to such an extent that it is impossible to install a standard skin repair, a special type of repair is necessary. The particular type of repair required depends on whether the damage is repairable outside the member, inside the member, or to the edges of the panel. Outside the member. For damage that, after being trimmed, as 812 rivet diameters or more of material, extend the patch to include the manufacturer's row of rivets, and add an extra row inside the members. Inside the member, for damage that, after being trimmed, has less than 812 manufacturer's rivet diameters of material inside the members, use a patch that extends over the members and an extra row of rivets along the outside of the members. Edges of the panel. For damage that extends to the edge of a panel, use only one row of rivets along the panel edge, unless the manufacturer used more than one row. The repair procedure for the other edges of the damage follows the previously explained methods. The procedures for making all three types of panel repairs are similar. Trim out the damaged portion to the allowances mentioned in the preceding paragraphs. For relief of stresses at the corners of the trim out, round them to a minimum radius of 1/2 inch. Lay out the new rivet row with a transverse pitch of approximately 5 rivet diameters, and stagger the rivets with those put in by the manufacturer. Cut the patch plate from material of the same thickness as the original or the next greater thickness, allowing an edge distance of 212 rivet diameters. At the corners, strike arcs having the radius equal to the edge distance. Chamfer the edges of the patch plate for a 45 degrees angle and form the plate to fit the contour of the original structure. Turn the edges downward slightly so that the edges fit closely. Place the patch plate in its correct position, drill one rivet hole, and temporarily fasten the plate in place with a fastener. Using a hole finder, locate the position of a second hole, drill it, and insert a second fastener. Then, from the back side and through the original holes, locate and drill the remaining holes. Remove the burrs from the rivet holes and apply corrosion protective material to the contacting surfaces before riveting the patch into place. Repair of lightning bolts. As discussed earlier, lightning bolts are cut in rib sections, fuselage frames, and other structural parts to reduce the weight of the part. The holes are flanged to make the web stiffer. Cracks can develop around flanged lightning bolts, and these cracks need to be repaired with a repair plate. The damaged area, crack, needs to be stop drilled or the damage must be removed. The repair plate is made of the same material and thickness as the damaged part. Rivets are the same, as in surrounding structure and the minimum edge distance is 2 times the diameter and spacing is between 4 to 6 times the diameter. Figure 4-181 illustrates a typical lightning bolt repair. 4-99. Extrusion angle stiffener. Repair to step station. Replace skin, splice a new portion, replace skin. A. Replace skeg. Detail A. Splice station 5. Splice. Shims. Repairs to keelson. Repair to step. Figure 4-178. Float repair. 4-100. Patch 0.016 outlet TM2024T4. 0.25 edge distance. 0.75 rivet spacing. 0.25 radius. Cut out damaged area. Skin. Use MS-20478D4 or MS-20600 self-plugging rivets or equivalent. Figure 4-179. Beaded skin repair on corrugated surfaces. Repairs to a pressurized area. The skin of aircraft that are pressurized during flight is highly stressed. The pressurization cycles apply loads to the skin, and the repairs to this type of structure requires more rivets than a repair to an unpressurized skin. Figure 4-182. 1. Remove the damaged skin section. 2. Radius all corners to 0.5 inch. 3. Fabricate a doubler of the same type of material as, but of one size greater thickness than, the skin. The size of the doubler depends on the number of rows, edge distance, and rivet spacing. 4. Fabricate an insert of the same material and same thickness as the damaged skin. The skin-to-insert clearance is typically 0.015 inch to 0.035 inch. 5. Drill the holes through the doubler, insertion, and original skin. 6. Spread a thin layer of sealant on the doubler and secure the doubler to the skin with clecos. 7. Use the same type of fastener as in the surrounding area and install the doubler to the skin and the insertion to the doubler. Dip all fasteners in the sealant before installation. 4-101. Repair seam same as strongest parallel adjacent seam. Repair seam same as strongest parallel adjacent seam. Use original holes and add as needed. 3/16, 5/32, 1/8. Additional rivets trim hole radius corners. Figure 4-180. Replacement of an entire panel. Stringer repair. The fuselage stringers extend from the nose of the aircraft to the tail, and the wing stringers extend from the fuselage to the wingtip. Surface control stringers usually extend the length of the control surface. The skin of the fuselage, wing, or control surface is riveted to stringers. Stringers may be damaged by vibration, corrosion, or collision. Because stringers are made in many different shapes, repair procedures differ. The repair may require the use of preformed or extruded repair material, or it may require material formed by the airframe technician. Some repairs may need both kinds of repair material. When repairing a stringer, first determine the extent of the damage and remove the rivets from the surrounding area. Figure 4-183 then, remove the damaged area by using a hacksaw, keyhole saw, drill, or file. In most cases, a stringer repair requires the use of insert and splice angle. When locating the splice angle on the stringer during repair, be sure to consult the applicable structural repair manual for the repair piece's position. Some stringers are repaired by placing the splice angle on the inside, whereas others are repaired by placing it on the outside. Extrusions and preformed materials are commonly used to repair angles and insertions or fillers. If repair angles and fillers must be formed from flat sheet stock, use the break. It may be necessary to use bend allowance and sight lines when making the layout and bends for these formed parts. For repairs to curved stringers, make the repair parts so that they fit the original contour. Figure 4-184 shows a stringer repair by patching. This repair is permissible when the damage does not exceed 2/3 of the width of one leg and is not more than 12 inches long. Damage exceeding these limits can be repaired by one of the following methods. Figure 4-185 illustrates repair by insertion, where damage exceeds 2/3 of the width of one leg, and after a portion of the stringer is removed. Figure 4-186 shows repair by insertion, when the damage affects only one stringer and exceeds 12 inches in length. Figure 4-187 illustrates repair by an insertion, when damage affects more than one stringer. 4-102. Stop drill ends of crack. Use number 40 drill repair for crack on lightning bolt flange. A. Patches same material and thickness as web. Repair for crack between lightning bowls. Figure 4-181. Repair of lightning bowls. Former or bulkhead repair. Bulkheads are the oval-shaped members of the fuselage that give form to and maintain the shape of the structure. Bulkheads or formers are often called forming rings, body frames, circumferential rings, belt frames, and other similar names. They are designed to carry concentrated stress loads. There are various types of bulkheads. The most common type is a curved channel form from sheet stock with stiffeners added. Others have a web made from sheet stock with extruded angles riveted in place as stiffeners and flanges. Most of these members are made from aluminum alloy. Corrosion-resistant steel formers are used in areas that are exposed to high temperatures. Bulkhead damages are classified in the same manner as other damages. Specifications for each type of damage are established by the manufacturer and specific information is given in the maintenance manual or SRM for the aircraft. Bulkheads are identified with station numbers that are very helpful in locating repair information. Figure 4-188 is an example of a typical repair for a former, frame section, or bulkhead repair. 1. Stop drill the crack ends with a No. 40 size drill. 2. Fabricate a doubler of the same material, but one size thicker than the part being repaired. The doubler should be of a size large enough to accommodate 1/8-inch rivet holes spaced 1 inch apart, with a minimum edge distance of 0.30 inch and 0.50 inch spacing between staggered rows. Figure 4-189. 3. Attach the doubler to the part with clamps and drill holes. 4. Install rivets. 4-103. E. Insertion. E. Skin. Remove damage. Doubler. 0.58. 0.40. Sealer. Insertion. Doubler skin. If damage has been cut away from center section of stringer length, both ends of new portion must be attached as shown below. Use AN470 or AN456 AD3 rivets. 0.064245T4 Alclad TM strip. A. 0.58. 0.10 rad. 3.35 3.35 0.90 0.90. A. 0.90 0.90 0.20. Figure 4-182. Pressurized skin repair. Most repairs to bulkheads are made from flat sheet stock if spare parts are not available. When fabricating the repair from flat sheet, remember the substitute material must provide cross-sectional tensile, compressive, shear, and bearing strength equal to the original material. Never substitute material that is thinner or has a cross-sectional area less than the original material. Curved repair parts made from flat sheet must be in the zero condition before forming, and then must be heat-treated before installation. Longyearn repair. Generally, longyearns are comparatively heavy members that serve approximately the same function as stringers. Consequently, longyearn repair is similar to stringer repair. Because the longyearn is a heavy member and more strength is needed than with a stringer, heavy rivets are used in the repair. Sometimes bolts are used to install a longyearn repair. Due to the need for greater accuracy, they are not as suitable as rivets. Also, bolts require more time for installation. If the longyearn consists of a formed section and an extruded angle section, consider each section separately. A longyearn repair is similar to a stringer repair, but keep the rivet pitch between 4 and 6 rivet diameters. If bolts are used, drill the bolt holes for a light drive fit. 0.04245T4 Alclad TM. Stringer CS14 and CS15. 0.50. 0.35. 0.35. AA. Original structure. Repair parts. Repair parts and cross section. Figure 4-183. Stringer repair. Spar repair. The spar is the main supporting member of the wing. Other components may also have supporting members called spars that serve the same function as the spar does in the wing. Think of spars as the hub, or base, of the section in which they are located, even though they are not in the center. The spar is usually the first member located during the construction of the section, and the other components are fastened directly or indirectly to it. Because of the load the spar carries, it is very important that particular care be taken when repairing this member to ensure the original strength of the structure is not impaired. The spar is constructed so that two general classes of repairs, web repairs and cap strip repairs, are usually necessary. 4-104. Reinforcement. Reinforcement. Damage area. Damaged area cut out smooth with corner rattle. Damage area. Damaged area cut out smooth. Filler. Filler. Assembled repair. Assembled repair. Figure 4-185. Stringer repair by insertion when damage exceeds 2/3 of one leg in width. Figure 4-184. Stringer repair by patching. Figures 4-189 and 4-190 are examples of typical spar repairs. The damage to the spar web can be repaired with a round or rectangular doubler. Damage smaller than 1 inch is typically repaired with a round doubler, and larger damage is repaired with a rectangular doubler. 1. Remove the damage and radius all corners to 0.5 inch. 2. Fabricate doubler, use same material and thickness. The doubler size depends on edge distance, minimum of 2D, and rivet spacing, 4-6D. 3. Drill through the doubler and the original skin and secure doubler with clecos. 4. Install rivets. Rib and web repair. Web repairs can be classified into two types. 1. Those made to web sections considered critical, such as those in the wing ribs. 2. Those considered less critical, such as those in elevators, rudders, flaps, and the like. Web sections must be repaired in such a way that the original strength of the member is restored. In the construction of a member using a web, the web member is usually a light gauge aluminum alloy sheet forming the principal depth of the member. The web is bounded by heavy aluminum alloy extrusions known as cap strips. These extrusions carry the loads caused by bending and also provide a foundation for attaching the skin. The web may be stiffened by stamped beads, formed angles, or extruded sections riveted at regular intervals along the web. The stamped beads are a part of the web itself and are stamped in when the web is made. Stiffeners help to withstand the compressive loads exerted upon the critically stressed web members. Often, ribs are formed by stamping the entire piece from sheet stock. That is, the rib lacks a cap strip, but does have a flange around the entire piece, plus lightning bolts in the web of the rib. Ribs may be formed with stamped beads for stiffeners, or they may have extruded angles riveted on the web for stiffeners. 4-105. Damage area. Damage area. Splice angles. Damaged area cut out smooth. Reinforcements. Stringer insertion. Damaged area cut back, so joints will be staggered. Rib repaired. Insertion. Assembled repair. Damaged skin cut back to smooth contour with corner radii. Assembled repair. Figure 4-186. Stringer repair by insertion, when damage affects only one stringer. Most damages involve two or more members, but only one member may be damaged and need repairing. Generally, if the web is damaged, cleaning out the damaged area and installing a patch plate are all that is required. The patch plate should be of sufficient size to ensure room for at least two rows of rivets around the perimeter of the damage, that includes proper edge distance, pitch, and transverse pitch for the rivets. The patch plate should be of material having the same thickness and composition as the original member. If any forming is necessary when making the patch plate, such as fitting the contour of a lightning bolt, use material in the zero condition, and then heat treat it after forming. Damage to ribs and webs that require a repair larger than a simple plate probably needs a patch plate, splice plates, or angles and an insertion. Figure 4-191. Leading edge repair. The leading edge is the front section of a wing, stabilizer, or other airfoil. The purpose of the leading edge is to streamline the forward section of the wings or control surfaces to skin, rib, section AA. Figure 4-187. Stringer repair by insertion when damage affects more than one stringer. Ensure effective airflow. The space within the leading edge is sometimes used to store fuel. This space may also house extra equipment, such as landing lights, plumbing lines, or thermal anti-icing systems. The construction of the leading edge section varies with the type of aircraft. Generally, it consists of cap strips, nose ribs, stringers, and skin. The cap strips are the main lengthwise. 4-106. Stop drill number 40 drill hole. Bulkhead. Crack. 1.5 minimum. Doubler. Radius to rest and bulkhead. Or. Stop drill number 40 drill hole. Bulkhead. Crack. 1.5 minimum. Doubler. Radius to rest and bulkhead. Figure 4-188. Bulkhead repair. Extrusions, and they stiffen the leading edges, and furnish a base for the nose ribs and skin. They also fasten the leading edge to the front spar. The nose ribs are stamped from aluminum alloy sheet or machined parts. These ribs are U-shaped, and may have their web sections stiffened. Regardless of their design, their purpose is to give contour to the leading edge. Stiffeners are used to stiffen the leading edge and supply a base for fastening the nose skin. When fastening the nose skin, use only flush rivets. Leading edges constructed with thermal anti-icing systems consist of two layers of skin separated by a thin air space. The inner skin, sometimes corrugated for strength, is perforated to conduct the hot air to the nose skin for anti-icing purposes. Damage can be caused by contact with other objects, namely, pebbles, birds, and hail. However, the major cause of damage is carelessness while the aircraft is on the ground. A damaged leading edge usually involves several structural parts. FOD probably involves the nose skin, nose ribs, stringers, and possibly the cap strip. Damage involving all of these members necessitates installing an access door to make the repair possible. First, the damaged area has to be removed and repair procedures established. The repair needs insertions and splice pieces. If the damage is serious enough, it may require repair of the cap strip and stringer, a new nose rib, and a skin panel. When repairing a leading edge, follow the procedures prescribed in the appropriate repair manual for this type of repair. Figure 4-192 repairs to leading edges are more difficult to accomplish than repairs to flat and straight structures, because the repair parts need to be formed to fit the existing structure. Trailing edge repair. A trailing edge is the rearmost part of an airfoil found on the wings, ailerons, rudders, elevators, and stabilizers. It is usually a metal strip that forms the shape of the edge by tying the ends of a rib section together and joining the upper and lower skins. Trailing edges are not structural members, but they are considered to be highly stressed in all cases. Damage to a trailing edge may be limited to one point or extended over the entire length between two or more rib sections. Besides damage resulting from collision and careless handling, erosion damage is often present. Trailing edges are particularly subject to corrosion because moisture collects or is trapped in them. Thoroughly inspect the damaged area before starting repairs, and determine the extent of damage, the type of repair required, and the manner in which the repair should be performed. When making trailing edge repairs, remember that the repaired area must have the same contour and be made of material with the same composition and temper as the original section. The repair must also be made to retain the design characteristics of the airfoil. Figure 4-193. Specialized repairs. Figures 4-194 through 4-198 are examples of repairs for various structural members. Specific dimensions are not included since the illustrations are intended to present the basic design philosophy of general repairs, rather than be used as repair guidelines for actual structures. Remember to consult the SRM for specific aircraft to obtain the maximum allowable damage that may be repaired and the suggested method for accomplishing the repair. 4-107. Damage cutout 0.50R minimum all corners. A. Web. A. BB. 3. 2D minimum, typical. 1. Spar cord. Aft. Note. Use this repair at the import end of the spar when the damage is near the upper or lower cord. 2. 0.050. 0.070. Web 3. Gap, typical. 2. 1. Fillet seal, typical. Make a laying surface seal refer to SRM 51-20-05 seal heads, typical. Figure 4-189. Wing spar repair. Inspection openings. If it is permitted by the applicable aircraft maintenance manual, installation of a flush access door for inspection purposes sometimes makes it easier to repair the internal structure as well as damage to the skin in certain areas. This installation consists of a doubler and a stress cover plate. A single row of nut plates is riveted to the doubler, and the doubler is riveted to the skin with two staggered rows of rivets. Figure 4-199. The cover plate is then attached to the doubler with machine screws. 4-108. Upper flange. Case A, case B. Spar web. Damage. Lower flange. Patch. Same material and thickness. Figure 4-190. Wing spar repair. If web stiffener is within 1/2 of hole and is not damaged, drill out stiffener rivets. After repair is made, rivet stiffener at original location. Add new stiffener if stiffener is damaged. Rib. Original damaged web area. Reinforcement material same as original and of same gauge or 1 gauge heavier. Clean hole smooth. Reinforcement plate. Pick up rivets along flange, add reinforcing rivets spaced 3/4 as shown, maintaining 2 1/2 times rivet diameter for proper edge. Figure 4-191. Wing rib repair. 4-109. Rib access hole in nose beam 0.50R minimum, typical. Nose rib. 0.63-0.94 spacing 2 evenly staggered rows at 0.55 minimum pitch. Repair plate. 0.35 minimum edge margin. Nose beam. Doubler. Figure 4-192. Leading edge repair. Patch to be 0.01624's T4 outlet. Filler strip 0.01624's T4 outlet. 0.90.90.90.9. 0.70.70. A. 0.40.40. Damaged portion cut away 6.00 maximum. 0.70.70. Original structure repair parts and cross section. 0.60 minimum. 5.00 maximum. 0.60 minimum. Bottom skin. Use AN470 or AN456 AD3 or equivalent Cherry self-plugging CR163 rivets. Replacement section of trailing edge strip 0.03224 ST4 outlet. A. 15 degrees. 0.8. 1.25. 11.60 min. 2.80 minimum. 3.0 minimum. 3.0 minimum. 2.80 minimum. 0.38. 0.06R. 0.254.8. A. Figure 4-193. Trailing edge repair. 4-110. Remaining portions of existing member. Trim damage. Continuous line of fasteners at uniform spacing required full length to join repair element. Repair element. Trim damage. Continuous line of fasteners at uniform spacing required full length or repair element. Existing member. Repair element. The required quantity of fasteners used to install the repair element is equal on both sides of the trim damage. Figure 4-194. C-channel repair. 4-111. E. Insertion. Doubler. C. Z-section. Supporter skin. Supporter skin. Supporter skin. C. Doubler. C. Supporter skin. Supporter skin. Supporter skin. Figure 4-195. Primary Z-section repair. 4-112. Insertion. Existing channels. Skin. Angles. P. C. Figure 4-196. New channel repair. 4-113. Trimmed area. Channel. Patch thickness of channel. Rivets. Drill no. 30.0.128. Finished repair. Figure 4-197. Channel repair by patching. Patch angle thickness of channel. Trimmed area channel. Patch angle thickness of channel. Finished repair. Drill no. 30.0.128. 1/2 spacing. Approximate. Rivets. Figure 4-198. Channel repair by insertion. 4-114. Access hole clean, smooth, and round. Length is minimum of 7 to match the reinforcement doubler that is being installed. 7. Reinforcement doubler plate. Rivets material thickness of 0.040 or less. Use 1/8 rivets. Rivets material thickness greater than 0.040. Use 5/32 rivets. Plate nut. 1 maximum. Reinforcement material outlet TM2024T3. Same gauge or 1 gauge heavier. 1/4 minimum. Skin. Access hole cover thickness of skin. Figure 4-199. Inspection hole. 4-115. 4-116. Chapter 5. Aircraft welding.